Hi everyone, and I just wanted to welcome, first of all, I want to welcome all of you to our roundtable conference on how Maharashtra can infuse innovation and creativity in its education. I'll just also briefly tell you what I'll talk about over here. So, my report, just thinking out of the box in education, what India can learn from Israel, which somehow seems to have been the initial boiling pot of actually bringing us all together. How Israel educates itself for security and prosperity, and what we Indians can learn from Israel. And of course, our roundtable, which is the meat of the discussion, and the outcomes that we hope from this roundtable. So, going over to my report. So, actually, it all started with a report, my visit to Israel, and to attend a course by Mashav course on ICT and science and technology in education. And everyone knows about Israel, you've heard about it, but only when you go there you really experience how it's a place of contrast, but it's a place from where you can learn a lot. And just to give a little bit of perspective, actually, this is a very tiny country. If you were to fit it in India, it's smaller than a state like Kerala. India is like 158 times the size of Israel. And the population of this country is 7.9 million people. It is much less than even Mumbai. But the number of achievements that they have to their credit is amazing. The highest proportion of university holders, 8 Nobel laureates in just the last decade. Need I mention the number of patents, the number of startups that they have. And when you see Israel, you know, it's very important. I'm just saying this so that just we relate to the country a bit. They have a very strong sense of national identity. The military service that all the children go to, that actually, I think, gives them a little bit of identity. And everyone are so patriotic, and they have a common goal. And they are very resilient. They are not afraid of failure. And that's the key point why there are more entrepreneurs. And they are very good at thinking on their feet and thinking out of the box. And sustainable living is a mantra. So for them, resources are really scarce. So they really make sure that they conserve them. And I think that's really key to anyone. So now just going to the crux of education itself. So education here is considered an essential and an important investment and not an expense. Around 7% of Israel's GDP is spent on education. I don't think we should even compare India here, which is less than 4%. And I'm just quickly, just a few scenes from schools there. I don't want to talk too much, but most schools in Israel are public schools. And when you go to a public school, you still see them, all the children happy, thriving. They have a lot of facilities, and they're learning a lot. The key things that we see there, teamwork, they're learning by doing, pathways to innovation. These are sixth graders who are showing off their robotics project. And what's interesting is that they also have a social context added to the robotics project. For instance, the kids were trying to help the elderly take some pills from one place to another. And of course, young kids, they have a greenhouse, they have a backyard in their school. Okay, that's when, even in that small space, they have some little real estate for it. And the children grow plants, and the other one is actually a globe, which is made of waste material, which was a project which all the school children did together. And of course, arts is not far behind, so they have several avenues for creative expression. And 21st century learning, the buzzword. And so there are smart boards. And the teacher is more like a facilitator over here, but the children are completely engaged. And service to community doesn't fall behind. And it's not like just the children have all the fun, so the adults do, and they too learn. Well, that was me if you people missed it. And just to summarize, the Israel's education system focuses on a few key things. One is catch them young, so nothing is too difficult really for the children. So they're really open to learning, they're open to experiments, they're open to challenges. Learning by doing, working with the hand, trying things out, experimentation. Then providing children avenues to explore. So they have enrichment programs and so on. Fostering a spirit of inquiry. So children are not afraid to be wrong, so they always question. And 21st century education, science and technology is a running thread around. And what you get as a result, children with good life skills, real world knowledge, ownership and responsibility, problem solving skills, and entrepreneurship. Now, I'm just quickly going to just say what I think are the key factors which potentially contributed to this. So one is empowered principals. So we went to a school where a principal was thoroughly in charge of a class. She was actually bringing in startup classes for the children. Then she was changing the curriculum. She was adding additional hours for the school children so that they get to study more or learn more, work hands-on. And professional development program for teachers is also another key area, because they have a very formal structure in which there are a certain number of hours that the teachers have to do. And what's also more important is that the program that the teacher does is actually decided based on the teacher's expertise and the inputs of the principal, so that the development program is useful for the school. And 21st century education, though it's a buzzword, I mean, I just wanted to highlight very the key difference, in the sense that though there's a lot of technology, there's a difference between us who are digital immigrants versus the children who are digital natives. And it's important to understand that all the teachers are not, they're not very easily, they can not easily adopt computers. So it's very important to factor in the human element and make sure that the program is designed accordingly. Additional enrichment program and hours for children. So, and this is inside the school as well as outside the school. So there's a concept called Eshkol, for instance, where children spend around 3 hours in addition to their normal school. And they're working on programs like robotics, maybe nanotechnology, earth sciences, and the like. And you see the children, so they're full of ideas and they're getting exposed to so many things. And coming to digitization of the learning resources, for every program, every book, or every their curriculum, they have in fact 2 to 3 options of digitized material which the school can choose from. And finally, when they're digitized, the children get free learning material. And this is still in process, but the options are many for them. And another thing I just want to quickly highlight is the fact that Hebrew as a language is a fairly new language. It's actually, in some ways, it's been created, the new words that are actually, in fact, created month on month, year on year. And they have actually managed to create so many resources, textbooks, in fact, IT, you know, like the whole computers and the likes, which are on Hebrew. So why not it be as smooth for us? And so I was just saying that most, the entire school program, it focuses on actually creating innovators. So the children learn things from robotics, nanotechnology, earth sciences, green engineering, and the like. So it's like the sky is the limit. So maybe we can think of something and actually do a leapfrog. So now that was a conversation starter. And so coming to our roundtable itself, I wanted to just quickly set the context. So what we would like to discuss in the roundtable is it's actually divided into 4 segments. One is innovations, education innovations in the rural context. These are pictures from Prahlad Katole's school. He will talk on the rural context. And can we have a scheme that nurtures gifted children, especially from underprivileged backgrounds? Science and learning by doing. And we'll also share the best practices of BMC school, because there's a lot of good stuff that's happening over there. And dear friends, what I wanted to tell you is that this roundtable, we want to have really positive view of what we do over here. I mean, I said a few examples of Israel, that's just to get your get our creative juices flowing. And when we look at India, and what's say by India, just even Maharashtra, there's so many best practices, there's so many good things that are being done. It's just that they're happening in silos and they are not all institutionalized. I think it's happening around, but I'm just saying that it's again time for us to actually come together, put in all our viewpoints, discuss all the best practices, see what we can scale and take out. And we at ORF would like to create a platform where we can all come together and discuss, and with government support and involvement, see how we can effect a larger change. And of course, 2 hours is a very short time for all of us. So we would really like to hear from each and every one of you. So I apologize if each one can only speak for around 3 to 4 minutes or we say, hey, time's up. But this is just a stepping stone for more roundtables that are going to be planned ahead. And we would love to have you keep coming and let's do something good. So at the end, as ideas and action, we want ideas and action. We want to consolidate them, new projects and implementations for the road ahead. So I just want to leave you with a thought in now-ation.